love story.
So Dami and Venice, right?
Yes, Pastor.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Flash questions?
Yes.
Okay, flash questions, flash answers, right? Yes,
let's start.
Go ahead, Karina.
All right. Who fell in love first?
Dami. I did.
Okay. Right. Who is more jealous?
She.
I knew it.
No, really?
All right.
Okay, let's go.
Who is more romantic?
She is.
I am.
Good. Who takes longer getting ready to leave the house? Okay.
It's a bit of a tie, this one, yeah. To be honest.
Okay.
Who eat more?
Dami.
It's clear. Who drives better?
I do.
Who is more funny?
She is.
Who takes longer to shower?
Dami.
Wow, that was strong.
Very quick.
Yeah.
Who is gets stressed easier?
I do.
Dami, yeah.
I do.
I know the answer, but let me ask. Who is more forgetful? Dami. Of course.
Yes.
We have a proof now.
Of the girl there from Stanford Hill. Is that correct?
Of course it is.
Of course it is. Who is more clumsy?
Oh,
she is.
Dami is.
Oh, gosh.
Easily to break something.
Mistakes happen.
All right.
Who wins this?
I
okay. Great.
Okay. Who likes to sleep more?
That's me.
She does.
All right.
Okay. And who expands more?
She does.
Yeah, I do.
Karina.
Who likes to go out more?
She does.
And yeah, you are winning.
You know what? I have to prepare a trophy.
Yes.
You know what? I'm liking that. So, Chad, please remember, we have to have a trophy every Wednesday, okay? But a trophy, a physical one. Who is more organized?
She is.
I am.
You lost. Okay. Very well. So, Dami.
Yes.
I hope that your problems with memory, you know, not interfere in this moment, because it's very important for you to remember things. But you said that you were the one who fell in love first.
Yes.
So, but before we enter in your love story, let us understand where you guys came from. So, Dami, how was your love life before having this encounter with the author of love?
So, before that, It was a you know, car crash. I was in a toxic relationship, so that meant I would do bad things, and there would be an immediate reaction, and then it would kind of be like tit for tat. So I was in a bad relationship, but I was a bad partner, and I couldn't stay faithful. I was in a long term relationship, but I would always have different people in that relationship, went, you know, going around doing different things.
So how is that? You are in a relationship, you are officially with someone, but at the same time, you are kind of free.
Yeah, I never understood about, number one, self-control. That was the one thing. But then also, I was doing what I saw other people doing as well. So it was like a natural thing. But it was one of those things where when you're in that state of mind, you don't actually realize how bad other things are around you as well. So you're kind of, you know, you're kind of blind. So my life around was also bad, and that it just kept on adding more fuel to the fire.
And what about you, Venice? How was your love life before?
Yeah, mine was also bad. I was, I think, about 16, 17 when I met someone, thought, you know, this is my everything, basically. I'm going to spend the rest of my life, or this is the person of my dreams, and gave myself to that person. And then one day I went to his house and saw another girl there. And then I ended it at that point, but I still had feelings for him. So I still cared about him, even though for me, the reason why I didn't go back with him was because I said to the girl at the time that if you go back with him, then you're a fool. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want to look like that.
Yeah.
So that's probably the main reason why I didn't go back with him, because I still liked him. I still even saw him after that moment. But it wasn't great at all.
And how did the love therapy helped you to overcome these traumas, especially you, Dami, to change this bad character had?
No, it was instrumental, to be very, very honest, because one of the main things that I learned was, you know, I had to meet the author of love.
Mm-hmm.
That was a very foreign concept for me, because I didn't, it wasn't something that, it made sense when you broke it down, mm-hmm. and, you know, you really thought about it, you know, that God is love, like, you know,
mm-hmm.
but when you're in that situation, when you're in that scenario, you have no idea. So coming to the love therapy seminars, I started to understand where I was going wrong and what I needed to change and why I needed to change. Starting, you know, from where the issues came from.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, it was the most instrumental.
So the love therapy for you was not an opportunity to find somebody else.
No. It was for me, it was the opportunity for me to discover who I was, to dislike that, but to hate that person, mm-hmm. and to change,
mm-hmm.
and to learn how to change.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very vital. Mm-hmm. Vital.
Right. Yeah. And how was the impact of the love therapy for you?
Same for me. I remember we had a purpose where we were turning the water into wine, mm-hmm. basically. And I remember saying to God, I want to be the best wine for my future partner, whoever it's going to be. I want to be the best wine. I really took part in that purpose very seriously. And whilst attending, I knew it just shows you things about yourself as well, I would say. So I was working on myself, working on becoming that wine, mm-hmm. that would be, you know, a blessing for someone else. And that's what I focused on, to be honest.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when I decided I was going to start coming faithfully to the love therapy, that's the year that Dami came back to the church.
Okay.
So it's vital, like Dami said, the love therapy for someone, mm-hmm. who's, you know, wanting to be that person, the suitable partner.
So mm-hmm. before you start your relationship to each other, of course, I'm assuming that you received the spirit of love first.
Yes,
right?
Yes. Definitely.
Okay. So after that, now you are a new Dami, you are a mm-hmm. new Venice, mm-hmm. everything's different. And when did you find that you were ready for the new relationship, Dami?
So for me, the funny thing was, my ex-partner actually came to the church.
Oh, really?
Mm.
And she wanted to change. And, you know, and the funny, very, very interesting thing was, she was actually doing well. She mm-hmm. was actually doing well, and you know, and for me it was like, okay, she's changing, I've changed, so what does this mean?
Mm-hmm.
But it because I, instead of me doing things the way I thought I wanted to do things, I asked God, you know, is this for me? If this is for, and it's this very scary, scary thing to say.
Mm-hmm.
If this is for me, let your will be done.
Mm-hmm.
It's very, very scary. because there's what mm-hmm. what you want, and then there's what, you know, you what God says. So when everything, you know, when God showed that this is not the person for you, this is not for you,
mm-hmm.
that's when I started to see, okay, actually, I need to continue on this path. And when it is God's time, he will reveal it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was almost like a natural thing, mm-hmm. as opposed to me forcing,
mm-hmm.
because I had learned that if I force something, I will get it wrong. More than likely, I'll do something crazy and get mm-hmm. something wrong. And I didn't want to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I literally said, you know, God, you know, let your will be done, which is a very scary thing, but it's the best thing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's basically how it happened for me.
Yeah.
And when you saw that you were ready for a relationship in Venice?
It was quite similar to what you just mentioned, Dami, because for me, whenever I used to come to the love therapy, I didn't feel like, oh, maybe I will speak to this person or, you know, I'm going to want to get to know this person. When I'm thinking back now, it was a thing where I wasn't even thinking about it in that aspect. It just happened. I remember it was in a December as well. And I had just taken part in that campaign.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't even for my love life. It was for my spiritual life too. Mm-hmm. So it was just... wasn't something that I was thinking of. Now this time is going to happen. And now, because we learn in love therapy not to be anxious.
Mm-hmm.
So we learn to fight against those anxieties and those feeling, oh, this person is getting married or this person is dating. When is it going to be your turn? Mm. So it was...
And how long did you take, Venice, from the day that you start in your faith
mm-hmm.
to the day that you were found, you know, by him?
Oh, how long? Well, I came to the church in about 2006, and then we met in 2000. And we first spoke in end of 2013.
Wow. So, Dami, you were the one who took, you know, the first attitude. Yes. So how was that? Because you were from Stanford Hill mm-hmm. and you're from Finsbury Park. Okay, you were not far from mm-hmm. each other. Mm-hmm. But still different branches. Mm-hmm. And how is that? Because, okay, it's not far, so I assume that events yeah. and everything mm-hmm. was here.
I would always see Venice, you know, counseling people, but not like, you know, just kind of, hey, but really helping people, really praying for people, really investing. And I would always see that and one day I thought to myself, okay, look, if she can speak to people that she doesn't know and really help them, then how would she be with a person that she loves, that she cares for?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of investment would she be in that person's life?
Mm-hmm.
I thought, I need that. I definitely need that. So I thought, okay, you know, definitely someone that I would like to speak to. But again, I observe a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I observe a lot and I realize.
And in this observation, what you were looking for?
I was looking for a virtuous woman.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So I looked at the friends that she had.
Mm-hmm.
I looked at how she interacted with people.
Mm-hmm.
I looked at, I listened to how people, you know, spoke about her.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, those kinds of things. I really, really, because for me, it is very, very important. I know that, you know, your partner can make you or break you. And that's just the reality. Yeah. So, and, you know, I didn't want to, again, make the same mistakes.
Did you know that you were being observed?
No, it's 1 year, isn't it?
Yeah, it was a year, 1 year of just...
1 year?
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, because, again, it's easy. There are many things we learn, especially in the church. It's very, very easy to, you know,
yeah.
do, but I saw a lot of that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of that, you know, but I really wanted to see, again, another thing that, you know, really, really... got me thinking was when I saw how she took care of people, let's say for people that had left the church, how she would hold on to them. Mm-hmm. Even when other people would say, forget about it.
Mm-hmm.
She would really, really, and she's still to this day.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, it was like, okay, if I ever become an idiot and I do something silly, she's gonna, you know, yeah. really. So again, those are the things that I thought, no, this is not just a normal person, this is a woman of God.
And didn't you notice, you know, a big guy like that staring at you? I can't imagine the VYG events, he's there, you know, dancing, looking at you. How is that, Venice?
That means, even though he mentioned these things, but he's actually quite discreet in things.
Okay.
So he's very, very subtle. You can't even tell if he's looking. He will just... I don't know how he does it, but he's quite discreet in those things, to be honest. So, yeah.
When did you have this assurance? Okay, she's the one. Let me do the approach.
It was just one day that I said, you know what? She is the real deal. She is the real deal. So.
And how was that? Because guys, they need to know how to do it. Because, you know, we have sometimes, you know, I have to say, Dami, sometimes in church, I don't know, these guys, I believe when they think then they receive the Holy Spirit, they have to be like angels. No, dear friend, you don't need to be like an angel.
Religious,
you know, religious. Yeah. You know. You are a man. Mm. And as a man, you are the hunter. Mm-hmm. So you have to go, you know. Because these guys, you know, they're people. They're men. I'm talking to men. Sometimes they become a bit wimpy when they start, you know, in their faith. So yeah. What was the...
So for me, the again, I'm, you know, I, you know, kind of think. So I thought to myself, okay, this is the woman that I definitely want. But I know for a fact that if I approach her, just, hello, how are you, blah, 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 blah. It's just, she probably will just say, hello, God bless, goodbye.
Was he right?
I think, I don't know, probably.
She definitely.
She would. Yeah.
So I said, okay, I'm not going to just go and it would just be quite awkward. So I said, what I'll do is, because I was attending, you know, Love Therapy every Saturday. So I said, okay, I'm not going to attend that Saturday. Mm-hmm. I'm going to, you know, do something else on the Saturday. And there's a person from my branch that I would always attend. I was friends with her. And I said, okay, you know what? Can you say to Ven, just at the end of at the end of Love Therapy, just say hello to her for me. Just say hello. Just say, all right. I just said, hello. Mm-hmm. Now, I knew it was a very simple thing, mm-hmm. but for me, I knew that if she said hello, Venice would more than likely be thinking, why would he ask someone to say hello to me? Why can't he say hello to me himself?
That's very weird, by the way.
Yeah, because then it would make her, I knew that she would at least think about me because I wasn't aware whether she was thinking about, I don't know if she knew me.
That was a strategy.
It was a strategy. It was a strategy to know that at the end of the day, she had thought about me.
Venice, how awkward was that?
Yes, very, very weird. I mean, the person came up to me and said, oh, Dami said to say hi. And for me, I was like, okay.
And
she was like, is that all you're going to say? And I was saying, what else am I supposed to say? And then I went upstairs to CBC to do what I was going to do. But he clearly achieved whatever he wanted to achieve. Because obviously we're here now today. But at the time, I was thinking, I didn't ponder on it too much, but I did think about it for a split second. So, you know, yeah.
So that was the main objective. Right. The main thing was to get her to think about because I didn't know what was, you know, whether she had thought about me at all or any, because I'd never spoken to her.
In the second step.
So the second step was, again, me going to approach her on the next day. So the next day, I think we were doing fundraising, right?
It was December, so yeah.
Yeah.
So I knew she was a hardcore fundraiser, hardcore. So I knew that
she's still.
Yeah. So I said, okay, after the Love Therapy, before she goes fundraising or anything, I'm going to actually go to her and speak to her. So so I did. And I was so nervous. I said hello. And then she actually, because we were standing near the chairs and in Finsbury Park. And then she had to say, Dami, are we going to sit down? I was so nervous.
Come on. She was leading the...
Yeah. Like, I was like, oh, yeah. Yeah. Do you want to sit down? Yeah, sit down. Let's talk. So then, you know, we sat down and we spoke and, you know, the introduction. And it was funny because our friends were behind and they were like, yeah.
So I had the fans there.
Yeah. So it was funny, but you know, just getting over that hurdle and then from there it was, you know, smooth sailing.
Mm-hmm. And then we spoke on that week and I think the week after we approached the bishop, Bishop James at the time, and then we said we're gonna get to know each other.
Okay.
It wasn't dating, and then Bishop advised us. And then I think it was about 2 or 3 months during that time we were praying, asking God, is this the right one?
Mm-hmm.
And then Bishop, we went back after 3 months to speak to the bishop to say yes, etc. And then he said, okay, now you can date. So we were doing, making sure that we
that's one
received
thing that
the right
very,
advice,
especially
right
for the young people. Like that was one thing that was very, very key. I think I missed out as well. I didn't just do this kind of on my own. Mm-hmm. So I went to her youth pastor, I went to her pastor, you know, I asked, and, you know, because when everything's open and everything's, you know, you can save yourself a lot of trouble.
Yeah.
A lot of hassle, a lot of problems, you know, on both sides. So that's very, very important, you know, doing it the right way. Just doing it. You have nothing to lose and everything to gain.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So you start dating.
Yes.
How long you've dating for?
Almost it was a while. Yeah, it was like 3 years.
Almost three years.
Yeah.
And how different was this dating from the previous dates?
I don't think there's a comparison, because before I came to the church, there was no, it was just physical. There was no, I know you and you know, there was none of that. It didn't know anything about me. Mm-hmm. It was probably just the name and, oh, you go to college, that's it. But there was nothing in the past, oh, this is what I overcame in the past or anything. But with me and Dami, we took time to get to know each other. We'd always be encouraged to speak. Mm-hmm. You know, finding out what our goals are, etc. Before, there was no, oh, what are your goals? What are your plans? We didn't really care about that back then, before I came to the church. But yeah.
For me, it was the spirituality of it that was, you know, but it wasn't like a religious spiritual. So, for example, you know, you call and, oh, what are you doing? Oh, I'm reading my Bible. Oh, is it?
So let us pray.
Yeah. No. But it was just like, pure. It just felt pure. Mm-hmm. And before, it wouldn't be, you know, what are you reading? It wouldn't be that question. Mm-hmm. So I knew that, you know, things are going in the right direction. And again, the other thing was, you know, when your conscience is clear, like you don't feel like, oh my gosh, did I do something wrong? Did I, you know, all that kind of stuff, because you know that, again, the author of love is guiding you as you do everything, as you're taking steps of the day to.
But this is very important, but not only, you know, the spirituality of this relationship, but also the things compose the, you know, the, a marriage or future marriage must be found in this talk. And in spiritual terms, you had a person of God, and that was a fact. But in terms of a wife and in terms of a future husband, what you were looking for in this dating time?
So for me, was she able to make and maintain a home?
Mm-hmm.
For me, that was very, very key, because I grew up with my mother, and I saw, and in different areas, different places. And I saw the difference between, you know, a woman that can make a home and a woman that can break a home. And it was very, very important for me to know that, you know, from her, with, you know, if is she able to do that? And then how is she able to take pressure? You know, in terms of, you know, a relationship, how her reactions, because again, as a male, as a husband, there's certain things, you know, certain reactions, certain things that we'd have to, you know, go through. So those are the key things that were very important in the dating stage. You know, how are we going to handle money? How are we, you know, just these things, very, very important things that sometimes are overlooked.
Because these things cannot be a surprise in the future.
That's the thing.
Yeah.
That's the thing because, you know, for example, like now, in terms of, again, dealing with money or dealing with the future, you know, these things are very, very important, and understanding what her thought pattern is and what my thought pattern is. Is there synergy? Is there a link between? Because again, like you said, Pastor, if we can be all, she can have the Holy Spirit, I can have it, but if at the end of the day we are not seeing eye to eye, it's just not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
And that was also for us when we sat down on our first talk. We spoke about, you know, goals and, you know, what, of course, over a period of time, what is it that you want to do? You know, what is your future goals? What are your plans? You know, and just also because at the time I was listening to Ms. Christiane and Bishop a lot, getting their advice about dating, the dating period as well, and just seeing how what I can get from their advice and apply it, you know, in the in the relationship. So that also helped a lot. But the goals was really, really important,
mm-hmm.
To be honest, making sure that we have the same goals. Do you want kids? You know, is this some, you know, very just important. These, you know.
To avoid future surprises.
Yeah.
There are couples that later, but they find out that they wanted different things.
Yeah.
But they didn't talk about it before.
Mm. Yeah, because just think, okay, you have the Holy Spirit. I am baptized with the Holy Spirit yet.
Yes.
So let's go.
Let's get married.
Let's get married.
You know, but you're not marrying the Holy Spirit. you're supposed to already be married with the Holy Spirit. Yeah. Okay. So have to understand that there is something that is very need there. You know, this... the thoughts, they mm-hmm. must be the same, and also the
goals, the dreams,
and not only that, but the attraction is very important as well.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, that was, you know, again, for me, she is what I wanted, and I need to be attracted to her. Mm-hmm. Like she's a woman of God. Yeah, yes, but if you're not attracted to her, you're setting yourself up for problems.
Yeah, it's true.
You know, it's just the reality of the situation. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. you know, these are things that I think what happens, maybe, you know, people can be scared of those things. Maybe if a person says, oh, I'm not that attracted to the person or something, they might feel they're being shallow. But it's just the reality of the situation.
It's true. You know, so, it's true.
Yeah.
Okay, so you decide to get married.
Yes.
Yes.
Who proposed?
I did.
Of course.
Of course.
Sometimes they're different.
Yes, yeah. sometimes.
That is okay. No problem.
But I'm asking, you know, because you never know. You never know, you know. I think I remember that. Yeah. Do you remember that, Venice?
Yes.
How was that?
It was very unexpected. I remember being at home and then I think you called me to say, I'm outside.
Mm-hmm.
And I went outside. He had flowers in his hands. And it was
very romantic.
On me. Nice.
Wow.
And it was very nice. I remember
and the neighbors looking at you.
I remember going back into my house, my room, and I was saying to my mom, oh, look.
Very happy.
So yeah, I was very happy. Yeah. It was very nice.
The thing for me was I'm kind of different. I don't really like, I saw there's always people doing different things when they want to, you know, get engaged. And I know that in my mind, I had it that, look, when we get married, every success is going to be between us.
Mm-hmm.
Every failure is going to be between us.
Great.
So the proposal is going to be between us.
Yes.
You know,
let me ask something. I don't know. We didn't talk about it before, but we have a problem here in UK, very common. People that they have different backgrounds, they have to face problems with a family. Did you guys face this issue?
So again, that was one of the things I was like, okay, look, the person that I want to be with has to have a strong family bond,
mm-hmm.
because I didn't come from a strong, a strong family bond. And I'm praying that the family is understanding, the family comes to the church, you know, these kind of things, because those are the things that I wanted in my family.
Mm-hmm.
So when I met her family and they were just like very accepting of me, they were just like as if I was always in her life.
Okay.
It was amazing for me.
I know it is that, Dami, because, you know, for my parents, this is a public complaint about, you know, my parents, they adopt my wife. Yes. So for them, she's my sister. She's not my wife. But never
treat
mind.
Treat me like
yes.
a daughter.
Can you believe it?
Yeah.
In their birthdays, she's the one to call and say, hey, I am their son, not you. Okay, never mind.
The funny thing is, like now, My mother takes her as a daughter.
Mm-hmm.
And the funny thing is, again, I'm Nigerian. She's Jamaican.
Mm-hmm.
Nigerians and Jamaicans.
Sometimes they clash.
Yeah, because they're so alike.
Yeah.
So I was kind of surprised at how much my mom takes to, I mean, she's like, and I'm kind of, you know, and I'm the only child. But
so that for you was a smooth process.
Very, 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 very smooth.
Yeah.
Very smooth.
I think the only, for example, when we did our traditional wedding in New York, we had the extras, if we could say, some of the faraway aunties was asking us about kids. But his mom, again, was very, very nice about it. And she sat us down. But it was, I didn't have any problems with his family at all. Yeah.
That's amazing. That's very good. Okay, wedding day, wonderful. You know, was party perfect, was perfect, pictures and everything. But real life starts in the day two, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So tell us now the challenges that you had to face in the beginning of a marriage.
So for me, you know, one of the key things with Venice, Venice is a very, she's very strong, like very strong and very strong willed. And for me, one of the things that that we had to slowly, you know, get through was if something happened, you know, just kind of saying sorry. Like, for me, I learned that if as long as no matter how I feel, if I can just say sorry, you know, mean it, you know, I'm sorry. Yeah. You know, you can move, you can solve a lot of problems by just saying sorry.
Yeah.
So, but, you know, for Venice, it, it didn't really come as naturally.
So she has to speak about it. Come on, Venice.
Really?
Yes, in the beginning.
Is it true?
Yes.
Okay.
In, Dami would always say sorry. If I did something wrong, he would say sorry to me. Mm. So it always... apologize and, you know,
a legit British, you know.
Apologize for everything. Sorry.
Yeah.
So he would always, you know, want there to be peace and just move on.
Uh-huh.
And I would not want to move on. I would want to stay upset and I wouldn't want, and I wouldn't say sorry. And I would feel eventually over
why
a period of time.
Why do that? Why don't you
I want to resolve
overcome
the problem.
Okay, continue, please.
So, over a period of time, so he would always be the one to apologize and just want to make peace. Mm-hmm. But then over a period of time, he kind of stopped saying sorry.
Oh,
yeah. Because for me, it was like, okay.
Because he wanted me to do it.
Yeah, because I was like, okay, it takes a lot of strength. It's, you know, it takes a lot of strength, especially if I, you know, you feel like you haven't done anything wrong to, you know, to say sorry and, you know, to apologize and then even to correct yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So when I saw that, it just... she was taking the easy way, the easy way. Okay, I know he's going to say sorry. I said, okay, you know what? It's going to be hard. I'm going to pray, but
no, sorry.
She's going to have to at least once. Just once. And then there was a day and it was, I could see she was really fighting, but she said, I'm sorry.
Like, oh, my
come
God.
On.
You remember
come
very
on.
Well.
Come on, Venice. How was this day? How was this day? You don't need to say what happened.
I don't even remember the day.
Ah, you don't, huh?
You remember.
Yeah, you remember this one, right?
Yeah.
But one thing that Dami would do, whenever I would say sorry, he'd always commend me for it. He'd be like, oh, you know, see what, you know. He would be so happy, you know, and just proud of me that I've said it and that I've actually... taking a step to change, because one thing that he always says is that, you know, the effort for me is what matters as well. So if you're making an effort, you know, I would push you to be that person that you want to become. So that's what it did.
Yeah.
So this is another thing that we can always see, you know, this kind of partner here among the couples, that after marriage, we start to discover new things about ourselves, things that we didn't know, things that they are new about us. For example, like this, perhaps you didn't notice that about yourself before, right?
That you
to be honest, I've never
sorry.
Really had to say it.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, when I was upset with my sister, even my mom before, I would never apologize to them. I would never say sorry to them. I'd just move on. And then before you know it, we start talking again.
Okay.
As if nothing happened.
That's what your way
before,
to apologize.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
You know, simply, okay, let's, you know, put it back and move on.
Different.
And for me, it was like, how do you just move on? How do we not do this again? Because I felt that if there was no acknowledgement and there was no, you know, actually think, okay, how do we, because then what would happen is that thing would happen again and again and again. It's like, no, we have to, you know, see how we can stop
it. It's a coma, you know, breathe and let's go.
Yeah,
let's
you have to recognize your mistake.
Yeah, because sorry is a kind of, you know, recognition when you say, okay, you know, I was wrong about it.
Mm-hmm.
Is she saying sorry today?
Yeah. No, she's... no, now we've developed so much where it's no longer just a sorry. It's okay, you know, this is what I was thinking at the time. Okay. You know, what were you thinking? And, you know, we actually discussed the situation and we come to a resolution. And for me, that's...
and you know, it, with years, and you were already married for 5 years, right?
Yes. Yes.
In, during these 5 years, you get to know each other much better.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So
definitely,
there is a point that, you know, a simple sight is enough.
Yeah, yeah. I know. I know when I've done.
She doesn't need to know.
Yeah, she's just
okay.
I know the different looks.
Yeah,
I'm getting to know more of the different looks.
Mm-hmm.
But now I like for me, she's basically my best friend. She's mm-hmm. my best friend, and
that's important.
The great thing is, you know, getting to know her more and more each day. I remember Bishop was saying, you know, women are like onions. You know, there's different layers.
Yes,
you know, different layers, and it's very, very true.
Yeah, my very friend.
We are different.
Very different, but we complete each other.
Yes, for sure.
And how has been these 5 years for you, Venice?
To be honest, we always hear in the church that marriage gets better with time. And for me, I always say, whenever ask me, how long have you been married? And I'm like, oh, 5 years. I wish it was 10 years already.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because for me, it's so amazing. It's so nice that you grow, you go through the problems. And one thing I say to Dami is that we go through problems, but we have each other.
Mm-hmm.
So we might not have everything that we want, but when we have each other, of course, above all, we have the author of love.
Yeah, sure.
We can overcome everything. So I'm looking forward to the years to come, to be honest, because it's only going to get better, and that's what I love about it.
May God bless you
all. Bye-bye.
Bye.
The Love Talk Show on Liberty Radio.